Good morning. How are we all doing? We good? Well, thank you for having me back. My name's Stu Fox. I was here last year talking about Hyper-V. I was here last year as a Microsoft employee, sort of one of my last gigs with Microsoft. I'm now working for Datacom. I'm a bit rusty, actually. I haven't presented to a crowd like this since basically last year. So if I get nervous and stumble on my words, it's because I'm out of practice. So I'm lucky enough to talk to you about today the Windows Azure Pack, which is a new bit of functionality that Microsoft are shipping as part of the 2012 R2 wave. And so what we're going to do today is have a sort of an overview over the whole lot of the Azure Pack, have a look at a few of the bits and pieces, how it works, what it's made up of, have a look at architecture and a bunch of demos as well. So hopefully we'll get through all of that in the hour and a quarter that we've got with time for questions. And if there's any questions during the thing, just interrupt. That's probably okay. So I guess when you think about what Microsoft are trying to do with the Azure Pack release, they've been running Windows Azure for quite a while now. And that's their cloud platform. But what they're trying to do with the Windows Azure Pack is trying to bring those same experiences and capabilities back on premises and also to hosters. So you can sort of see, I don't know if you noticed, but I noticed in the 2012 release there was quite a big focus on hosters, and it's the same with 2012 R2. But also, like I say, bring this on premises so you have a consistent platform that doesn't matter whether you're running in the Microsoft public cloud, whether you're running in a service provider's public cloud, or whether you're running in your own private cloud, you need a consistent experience. And there's some marketing things about transforming data centers and enabling apps and things like that and people-centric IT. So when we think about what the Windows Azure Pack's about delivering, there's basically a set of cloud capabilities that are coming in to the platform. So what Microsoft have done with the Azure Pack is they actually released it, I guess in what you might call a preview fashion. They released it, I think, January this year. They released a thing called, which I think is up there with the most awesome of Microsoft names, the Windows Azure Services for Windows Server. So, obviously a VP of sales or something got hold of it and decided it was a really good name. So I think Windows Azure Pack's probably a little bit more snappy. Don't know about you. So what we've done with Azure Pack is taken the stuff they're learning with Windows Azure. They flipped out this pre-release version, WAS-WIS, I call it, and Azure Pack, they're kind of delivering a more mature model. There's kind of these four key capabilities. The first thing is high-density websites. So running high-density websites that you can build modern applications on, they're highly scalable, and it's all on a self-service basis. So I can come in, just like I do in Windows Azure, provision up an IIS website, have it start running immediately, start provisioning my code to it, and integrate with source code control mechanisms like Git, even do things like the CodePlex and Dropbox style publisher that you can do in Azure now as well. Up. Can we get the volume turned up a bit? Thank you. So, better? Oh, it's not working on that side. Oh. We'll run over that side. I'm building a fall over. Hopefully one of these guys will fix it up. The next bit is, maybe I'll come and stand over here and talk over here. Next bit is Service Bus. So when Microsoft shipped the Windows Azure Services for Windows Server product, one of the biggest things they found was that people were asking for, we want Service Bus in this as well. So Service Bus is about developers building, needing messaging between, their modern applications and maybe between back-end systems. Being able to do a Service Bus style stuff on premises or in your service provider cloud. Next one is to provide a consistent experience across the virtual machine platform. So when I can run up virtual machines in Azure. Has anyone done that? Running virtual machines in Azure? A few of you? So kind of a consistent experience between what you do in Windows Azure and what you do on premises or with your service provider. And bringing in a few extra capabilities in terms of this thing called the gallery, so we can actually do scalable virtual machines as well and elastic virtual machines. And it, again, fully self-service. And I guess the last bit is the service management portal. So you have a consistent service management portal across Windows, Azure, and your on-premises deployment, and integrated with your Active Directory and integrated with ADFS as well. So if you kind of look at how Windows Azure is built, Azure's built of, I guess, what you call the Windows Azure Fabric underneath. On top of it, you've got the various cloud services, your websites, your VMs, SQL, service bus, caching, those kinds of things. On top of that, you've got a service management API. And then on top of that, you've got the service management portal. And that portal is basically where you do all your interactions with Windows Azure. And all that portal is basically a stateless thing. Everything goes through the API, talks to those services, and is provisioned. So when you think about how this is going to be enabled for an on-premises or for a service provider deployment, well, it starts with Windows Server 2012 R2 and System Center 2012 R2 with the Service Provider Foundation. Now, there's actually a lot of interdependent parts in the solution in terms of, you know, there's Virtual Machine Manager, there's Service Provider Foundation. I'm not going to be talking about those things today and what you have to do to make this run on those guys, but you do have to have those things in place to talk here. So just be aware of that because, you know, we just simply don't have time to cover off, you know, how to create your stuff in VMM and how to configure up Service Provider Foundation, those kinds of things. So then, what happens with the Azure pack? That same service management API comes across, so we get a consistent service management API, which means you can use the same tooling against Azure that you can use against the Windows Azure pack. And then that self-service portal moves on-premises, so we can have a same consistent experience, same look and feel. But we also have a provider portal available as well. So the provider portal is where your admins come in, create plans, create offers, and get an overview of the whole environment. And then some of those same roles come across. So we get websites, we can run virtual machines, we can do SQL databases as a service. Now, it's not SQL Azure on-premises. It's good old-fashioned SQL that we all know and love, and Service Bus. And Microsoft nicely refer to future services, so whatever they might be. I guess, you know, you might look at the other side and say, you know, maybe caching comes across. I don't know, but, you know, maybe mobile services comes across. Who knows? And then we get a consistent development experience, whether you're developing on-premises or in Windows Azure. So, like I said, built on Server 2012 R2, System Center 2012, and the Azure Pack. Now, I should say the Azure Pack's a free add-on to all of this. And so the bits you kind of have at the back end, Virtual Machine Manager, this new capability in System Center 2012 R2 called Service Management Automation. Has anyone heard of this? Like that guy. So Service Management Automation is a new component of Orchestrator, and what it allows you to do is to run PowerShell workflow-based orchestration. So instead of using the sort of the GUI that you do in System Center Orchestrator, you write all your workflows in PowerShell, and you manage that all and author that all through the Windows Azure Pack portal. And so, and make web services calls, and they go off and execute these PowerShell-based workflows for you. I'm kind of struggling with myself with knowing what's the difference between why would I use service management automation and when would I flick to Orchestrator. And the only answer I've got so far is you would use service management automation when you're using the Azure Pack, and otherwise you would use full Orchestrator. So that's the information I've had so far, but it may be more subtle than that probably. Ops Manager, optional, obviously. Service Provider Foundation, mandatory. Windows Server 2012 and Hyper-V. So what I'll quickly do is I'll give you a quick look at what the Azure Pack tenant experience is like. We'll do a couple of other bits of looking at it as we go through. But first, we'll have a look at Windows Azure. Just so we can compare. So this is Windows Azure. I don't know how many of you actually logged into Windows Azure and had a play, but it's here's the look and feel. Here's the Azure UI. It's pretty easy to create stuff. I can create a new website, and they make it really easy to do stuff. So if I want to provision, you know, a new CMS, I can come in and choose my CMS and you know, whatever it's going to be. Let's say it's, you know, Orchard CMS. I can just go through and configure it up, and away I go, and it's really simple, and it's provisioned in sort of a matter of minutes. So it's all kind of self-service. And, you know, the same with virtual machines. And, you know, I can create, you know, a new virtual machine and what image name I give it and all that kind of stuff. So I can just spin up these things as I wish. And, you know, it's Azure, so I've got kind of the illusion of infinite capacity. And with Microsoft, you know, with the Microsoft data centers, you know, you have got a fair bit of capacity there. So, you know, that's what we've got in Azure. So that's kind of the Azure experience. So what we'll do is have a look at my timed out session. We'll have a look at the Azure Pack experience. And so you'll see it's pretty similar. So same look and feel, same UI. You know, I've just got less stuff down here on the left that I can do. So I've got, you know, my websites, my VMs, and a few other bits and pieces. But I get quite a lot of the same capability, though. So with that website stuff, I can spin up a new website from the gallery. And same sort of thing. I can choose a CMS. And, you know, if I want to deploy, say, Orchard CMS, I can deploy that really quickly and easy using the same, exactly the same experience that I get with Windows Azure. So really, you know, really straightforward. And it is pretty much an exact copy of the Azure experience. Same with virtual machines. You know, I can spin up new virtual machines. It's a little different, but I can spin up new virtual machines, and away I go. And I can spin up Windows machines, I can spin up Linux machines, it doesn't really matter. So that's kind of a quick look at the Azure portal, and we'll have a couple of, we'll have a deeper dive in a couple of the other bits as we go through. Any questions so far? No? Good. So, I guess some kind of, how Microsoft are thinking about this, they kind of break things up into service consumers and service providers. I call service consumers users. You may call them something different. Pains in the, and so basically the idea with service consumer, they consume infrastructure and apps from service providers as off-the-shelf solutions or as a service, if you like. What they like self-service administration. They want to be able to acquire capacity on demand, you know. And if, like me, you know, you work with a bunch of guys who planning seems to be something that happens on another planet, they come up and go, I need these 20 VMs tomorrow, and I need all this stuff provisioned and all these networks created and everything done tomorrow. Would you mind making that happen? And that's kind of how I find, you know, that's not a reflection of Datacom. Or maybe it is. But, you know, I find that common across whoever I've worked with. It's we won't really think about this IT stuff. We'll just make sure that that can happen kind of at the last minute. It doesn't. But so it is kind of a thing. They want predictable costs. They want to know what they're going to pay. You know, Azure has that kind of all-you-can-eat, you can eat as much as you can pay for kind of model. You know, just spin up something and just start paying and keep spinning stuff up until, you know, until you've run out of money, basically. As a consumer, that's probably, you know, as an internal IT provider, probably not the greatest model for you, you know, if you're using your own private cloud. Yeah, but they want to get up and running quickly. So, you know, consumers of cloud services, probably developers and IT pros, like self-service, they build and deploy applications, managing their applications, and they're paying for the services. So, the first bit of Azure Pack, how we enable service consumers, is this websites. And what Microsoft did is earlier this year they released the website service into Azure, and that allows, and that's kind of high density website hosting. Basically, you know, going from running a single VM, running an IIS website and running and dedicated to that website, to running a shared platform where you're running multiple IIS websites, all delivering their content, but also highly scalable. So I can be elastic about these web applications. I can spin up new instances like that if I need to. They are integrated with source control, so I can, you know, push them with Git. I can push them straight from Visual Studio, those kinds of things. And I can see what's happening with my app with real-time data about what, you know, about the app. And I can use the various different languages and open source languages that I like. So it supports .NET, it supports PHP, it supports Python, it supports Node.js out of the box. So you don't have to worry about whether, you know, it's what the cool kids, what language the cool kids are programming in. It probably is running here. So here's kind of a snapshot of one of the dashboards, but I'll actually jump in and show you that on the live system. So here's a website. Here's my website's view. So I showed you before, you know, I can spin up a new website really easy. You know, I can just create a new website and create a website. And away I go, and it spins up a website for me, and that's kind of done, and there you go. I can browse to it, and you know, there's nothing there, obviously, but it's just up and running real quickly, straight away. But what I can do with these websites is, if I go in and have a look at one, I get a nice dashboard about my website, which is that dashboard I showed you before. So I can see what's happening, what you know, what data's coming in, how much CPU it's using, those kinds of things. You know, I can see kind of the summary of my plan, how much file system space I'm using, how much memory I'm using out of my plan. And so I can get a whole bunch of information about my app. The other thing I can do is come in and say, you know, hey, my app's a .NET 3.5 app, so I need it to be running in that application pool, so I'll change it to .NET 3.5. I'll turn PHP off. I can enable, do things like enable WebSockets. I can upload SSL certificates. I can manage custom domain names, so it's you know, so I can have my own domain name pointing at the website running here. And I can turn on things like web server logging, because you know, when you're running these things on a self-service basis, you know, devs still want to see the web logs. Other people still want to see the web logs, or they want to see the detailed error logs, or they want to see failed request tracing. So I can turn that stuff on and make that stuff available, you know, really easy to do that by myself. You know, so I'm just logged in as standard old Joe user here. And it's done, all that stuff's turned on. So, oh, and I can manage my default documents, that kind of stuff. And one of the other things, one of the greatest things about it is this concept of elasticity. So, for instance, at the moment, I'm running with one instance of that web server. I can scale it out up to three instances. I'm not going to do that because I've only got one web server backing it, and it'll just fall over. But so you can see, it's really easy to come in and say, I need to scale this up fast, and it will bang. You know, you saw how quickly that website got provisioned before. It'll just run another instance. Question here. So the question is there any way to scale automatically? And the answer to that is no in this release, or at least I haven't seen it so far, but what I have noticed is that Windows Azure are doing automatic scaling and scheduled scaling now. I think they just put scheduled scaling to preview today. So if I thought about future services, you know, I might imagine that might come in. You know, I can see that happening. Yeah, so at the moment, there isn't this concept of auto-scaling, but I think it might later on. I get a, you know, again, that kind of monitor view as well. So it's really easy to do that kind of stuff. The other thing is obviously how do I get content up to this guy? Well, one of the ways is just straight FTP, so I can FTP to the environment. I can FTP up, and here we are. I'm at my website. I can, you know, put new content up there, and I can also come and see, you know, if I've got logging turned on, which I don't at the moment. If I've got logging turned on, I can come and see logs and those kinds of things through the FTP site. So again, all self-service. I don't have to involve an admin. I'm just an ordinary user. I'm provisioning my own resource, doing all that kind of stuff. And you know, actually, if you look over here, there's also publishing profiles for Visual Studio, so I can download that, import it to Visual Studio, and push my content straight to the website. And also, I can enable it for Git publishing as well, so I can push from Git, which you know a lot of the open source folks use, push straight from Git to the Azure websites as well. So really, really easy to do this stuff. So pretty straightforward. And, you know, like I say, that same gallery stuff's available as you would normally have in Windows Azure. So that's kind of what the website stuff looks like. And I'll talk a bit about what the architecture of that looks like in the back end. I'll talk about that a bit later. So the next one is virtual machines. So again, the concept of bringing an Azure consistent infrastructure as a service platform through for end users to run, you know, or run your private cloud, run your hoster. Same user experience, same API, so same tools, same, you know, all that stuff's happening. And we can do standard old virtual machines if you want to. You know, you can run up, you know, just go, I want a new Windows machine, run it up, away it goes. But it also brings this concept of what's called a virtual machine role, which is a little different when you think about it. It's if you're familiar with VMM service templates give you that ability to say, I've built this service and I want to be able to scale different parts of the I want to be able to scale different parts of my service so that I can run up multiple instances of a particular part of the service. And virtual machine's role is the same kind of thing with a virtual machine instance. It can be elastic. I can say, I want to be able to run one instance, but scale another instance out and make it, you know, run 2, 3, 4, 5 instances of the same copy of this virtual machine. And that's all done through this thing called the gallery. And that supports Windows and Linux. The other thing that also comes into the Azure pack is the virtual network stuff. So this sort of the VPN from a customer to a service provider, you can do that same stuff that you would do with Windows Azure. And, you know, tenants can bring their own IP addresses, supply their own IP addresses into the infrastructure server side and create their own virtual networks and that kind of stuff. So it's pretty powerful. And again, we'll have another, we'll have a look at that as well. So virtual machines. Again, it's pretty straightforward. If I want to create a new virtual machine, I'll create a virtual machine. In fact, I'll do that. First thing is, there's those two. There's standalone virtual machine, which is basically I want to spin up a, you know, I want to spin up a Linux VM or a Windows 2012 VM. And give it a name. Password. Skip that whole product key thing. No one uses those. What network I'm going to connect to? So those these networks correspond to virtual machine manager logical networks. And go off and provision. I won't bother provisioning at the moment because it takes ages and we were just standing around waiting. But if we look at, you know, I've got a machine provisioned here already. Similar sort of thing. I've got a dashboard view, so I can sort of see. I can see what my machine's been up to for the last hour, which is virtually nothing, and I can see kind of a summary of what it's using compared to my, you know, so the green bit's what I'm using, the dark grey bit is my subscription, how much I'm using overall, those kinds of things. Now this is a Linux machine, so I can see, you know, it's running Ubuntu Linux, it hasn't got an IP address at the moment. One of the cool things is I can do console connect from the portal. So this kind of blows my mind. I just RDP'd to a Linux box. So the console connect. And so my advice to you on the console connect is if you want to go and play with this stuff in the preview, don't try and set the console connect up because it's A, not documented, and B, the documentation they do give you is wrong anyway. If you are going to have a play with the preview, just get in touch with me because I know how to do it. I'm just not sure if I'm allowed to publicly say how to do it. I understand it's all going to be fixed in RTM because it is kind of, it's just not documented at all. But basically it uses the new capabilities inside Service Provider Foundation. It uses the new capabilities you need to have Windows 8.1 or a Server 2012 R2 RDP client. And I understand that's all coming, getting a bit backported as well at some point, but at the moment that's what you need. You need an 8.1 RDP client to be able to support this. Because I'm logging on as a user that doesn't have any privilege at the Hyper-V side, and potentially I don't even have a log on in the Hyper-V environment because I might be coming from ADFS log on. So I might not have any privilege at all, and so it does a whole bunch of tricks around this to get me in, which is pretty clever. It just takes a bit of mucking around to get working. But it is, you know, really helpful. And there's, I think, with the Windows boxes, with the Windows box here, I can also, and this doesn't work at all, but you've also got an RDP connection available as well. So you can RDP via a service provider provided RDP gateway or RDS gateway. So you know, pretty cool. So that's what we do there. Now, the other bit was the virtual machine role kind of stuff. So if you compare that one there, I've got dashboard and configure, and I can configure, you know, in a normal standard old standalone virtual machine, I can configure up the size of the VM, and that's pretty much it. In this virtual machine role, I've got a couple of extra tabs here, which is the instances tab and the scale tab. So the instances shows me what's actually running right now. So I've got one VM running in this role called computer 001, rather imaginatively named. But I've also got this scale tab. And so I talked about being able to elastically scale these VMs. So I could go, you know, 2, 3, 4, 5 VMs, save that, and it will go off and provision me the extra 4 VMs that I need. And they'll be identical copies of the other one, so it'll just bang, spit them out as they go. So that's kind of handy, and that kind of works in the same way as VMM. You've got kind of a maximum, a minimum, and a startup count. So basically when I spin up this thing initially, it might have 2, it can shrink down to 1, or it can grow up to 5, those kinds of things. And so that's this role-based role-based VMs, and they come from a gallery of VMs, which are, if we go to the gallery, I can spin up, let's just show you the provisioning experience. Same sort of thing, but instead of, I've got these kind of extra small, small, medium, large, and extra large, which are actually not defined by me at all. These are defined in the role definition, and they actually correspond pretty tightly to what happens in Azure as well. But I can set up, you know, the computer naming pattern. So how do the computers actually get named? So you saw that first one was computer 001. So the next one will be computer 0002 and those kinds of things. And I talked about initial instance count and minimum. So, you know, you might say start with 3, shrink to 1 if you need to, grow to 5. So it just sets those parameters, go off and provision that, and it'll go off and do that for me. And there's a bit of stuff you've got to do for this in the back end with VMM, and some stuff you have to do inside the admin portal around this as well to make these things available. But this is extensible, so you can build your own roles as, you know, as a service provider. You could say, you know, here's an AD, here's a SQL, here's BizTalk, here's whatever. So then you spin up a BizTalk role and away you go. It comes pre-enabled with BizTalk. So that's the virtual machine experience. Any questions there?
For multiple instances, if you're exposing out an endpoint, does the Azure pack the software network load balancer?
The question is, if you're running multiple instances, does the Azure pack come with a software network load balancer? No, it doesn't. You could configure up. You could configure up NLB, for instance, if you wanted to. So, you know, Microsoft network load balancing, if you're allowed to do that, or if you want to do that, that'd be the way to do it.
So you could provision your instances, but then you have a post-provisioning step in
configuring NLB, yeah. I'll just have a bag of pineapple lumps. I'll try not to hit anyone in the head. It's close. That's why New Zealanders can't play cricket, by the way.
Aussies can't as well.
Yeah, all right. Aussie can either. Yeah, okay. Turns out England can, though. Yeah, who would have thought? So next bit is Service Bus. So Service Bus is kind of a developer-y thing, and I, I kind of just wave my hands around and go, it's Service Bus. There you go. if you guys know about Service Bus, then this is basically the Windows Azure Service Bus brought to Windows Server. So basically, you know, you poke messages into the Service Bus. You can create your own namespaces for the Service Bus through the portal. You can poke messages into it as a developer, retrieve those messages via some other system or whatever, using standard protocols, so REST, AMQP, WS, standard development languages, so it, you know, it's kind of a built to be interoperable, and so you can do all that through the management portal. And so that's Service Bus. That's my hand waving. Is that the queen over there? I'm not going to show you a demo because basically then you would all laugh at me. So I guess the other bits are the kind of these additional features. The big one is identity. So when Microsoft released that preview of Windows Azure Services for Windows Server, the identity bit was really missing. There was no real... there was basically identity stored in a database, and that was kind of it. And so for a lot of enterprises, that was kind of a pain. The interesting thing is that a whole bunch of enterprises ran it up anyway, because it actually is a really capable portal. And but Active Directory integration means that you can now have your tenants, your consumers, be, you know, Active Directory users or ADFS users. If you're a service provider, they can log in with their federated credentials. And also, it brings in this concept of co-administration. And so the co-administration stuff allows you to have multiple consumers administering resources in the Azure Pack environment. So I can have, you know, so it's not just me administering resources. In fact, I'll just quickly show you that. When I go to my account, I can see all my subscriptions. So I'm subscribed to three different plans. I've got web hosting, I've got gold VM hosting, I've got a VM hosting one which has failed because I was silly. And but when I come in here, I can see I've got a couple of co-administrators. So I've got this bloke, Tony Abbott, who he's able to see my web hosting plan. I've got this other guy, Kevin Rudd, and he's able to see my VM hosting. So those guys can log in with their own credentials. In fact, finally, a legitimate muse for in private mode. So, ignore all the certificate stuff. I'll log in. Don't tell your Prime Minister that I'm doing this. And as I log in as him, I can see the same virtual machines that I saw as my primary subscription owner. So basically, that co-administration. And one of the things they've introduced in the Azure Pack is also group co-administration. So you can have an Active Directory group as a co-administrator. That Active Directory, and then obviously members can come and go from that group, and they'll have permissions to whatever resources are in here. So that's quite handy as well. So a couple other, we can add SQL Server in, and we can add MySQL Server in as well. So end users can come to provision SQL Server databases and MySQL databases, and then any other value-add services as well. And there is also an extensibility API, so you can wrap your own services in this if you want to. So if you've got some other stuff that you want to provision through the portal or whatever, you can do that with the extensibility API. Microsoft ship or at least they shipped in the Azure Services API documentation, a GoDaddy DNS management API, so you can manage GoDaddy DNS providers through the Azure portal. And there you go. And also standard API access to the cloud service. So let's just switch over to talk about service providers. So got service providers who, you know, they're providing cloud services. It could be an enterprise, could be a hoster. They're deploying a bunch of shared resources, but they really don't have the same capability to scale as say Windows Azure does. And they create offers for consumers. They've got a big focus on cost. You know, I work for a hoster, our job is to basically make our profit as big as possible and make our cost as low as possible. And you know, that's one of the things we try really hard to do. It can be a bit hard. So what we do is, as a service provider, we create a plan, and those plans are unique combinations of the various bits and pieces. You might have, and they might be SLA differentiated, for instance. One of the things that you can do with, say, the SQL backend is you can provide SQL always on databases, but that could be a separate SLA as opposed to standard SQL offering. And so you can have a different plan, a gold level plan, which has got HA and all that kind of stuff, SQL always on available and those kinds of things. So you build these plans, and I'll show you this in a sec. I'll show you that right now. So from an admin experience, this is the admin portal. Fundamentally, doesn't look a lot different, but instead of seeing all the stuff, you can see the various bits and pieces that are involved in the infrastructure. So this is the website's hosting infrastructure, and I can see I've got a whole bunch of different bits available to me. Provisions, so I've got workers provisioned, I've got a publisher, I've got a REST server provisioned, I've got a front-end provisioned, file server, and a controller. And I can come in, and as an admin, I can see what websites have been provisioned. I can come in and can configure up some of this stuff, so I can say, what's a default cert I can use, what's the publishing URLs, those kinds of things. And the same with virtual machines. I've talked to my VMM endpoint, my service provider foundation endpoint, and I've got a cloud defined in VMM. I can come in and see what virtual machines are there. Actually, there's quite a lot. So I can see all the different virtual machines that are running. And I can link to this automation stuff as well. And it's the same with service bus and SQL Server and that kind of stuff. But what I can do with a plan, though, is I can create a new plan. And let's create a plan. Call this ticket U, and I can say what different things am I going to make available in this plan. So I might say this is only for doing virtual machines, and there's no add-ons available, so I've got this plan, and basically now I've got to configure up some of the things about the plan. So the first thing is I've got to configure the virtual machine. So I've got to say, what VMM server am I talking to? And what cloud are they going to be able to provision into in VMM? And then I can say, they're only allowed to create 10 VMs in this plan, and they're only allowed to use 20 cores or a maximum of 20 cores, use as much RAM as they like, and I'll limit their storage to, 10 gig or something. I can choose the networks they're allowed to see. This might be a network for a particular tenant, or it might be a plan for a particular tenant. What hardware profiles can they use? And so these are coming out of VMM. And same with templates. What templates are they allowed to use? And these are, again, these are just templates in VMM. And what templates are they allowed to use? And what gallery items? And we saw those gallery items before. They're those scalable virtual machine roles. And so I can say, yep. Cool. And I can also say what other bits and pieces are they allowed to do. So, I do want them to connect to the console. I don't particularly want them to create checkpoints or snapshots, as you might otherwise call them. And so I save that. And my plan is configured. And then a couple of the other bits and pieces that you have to do is you can... If you want to make this plan available but not allow everyone to just sign up to it, you can set an invitation code. And to sign up to that plan, you need to also provide the invitation code. So, so not just Joe Blogs just can't come and sign up to your plan. They need to provide that. I can also, if I really want to, I can actually, go into to a user over here, and I can actually add that private plan to a subscription as an administrator if I want to. The other thing I can do is, once it's configured, I can just change the access here and make it public. And go, yep. And once it's made public, then anyone who's got the invitation code can now come up and sign up to that plan, and away we go. It's as easy as that. So that's kind of what we do as an admin. It's how we provision a new plan, how we make it available.
How does the subscriptions work with that? Is each person signing up creating their own subscription?
So the question is how does the subscription work? Does each person signing up create their own subscription? Yeah, but basically that is kind of how it works. Everyone who signs up chooses a plan they want to use. That creates a subscription for them, and away they go, they're in. Unless you're doing that co-administration model where you can sign in and be associated with someone else's subscription. That's the only other.
Can you create a situation where one subscription's holding many different people?
Can you create a situation where one subscription's holding many different people? No, you could have one plan that has different customers as end users or subscriptions against that plan, but you couldn't have one subscription and multiple customers in that subscription. The only way to do multiple users inside a subscription was with co-administration. Have a pineapple. Good, honest Kiwi lollies. How do you charge back? I'll get to billing in a second, if that's all right. In fact, I planted that guy. So the concept with billing, and I'll be honest and say that the billing, the information about billing, there actually hasn't been a lot out of it out there publicly around billing at the moment. Here's what has been communicated by Microsoft in terms of the billing stuff, is that the idea is that there's a usage tracking engine inside the Azure pack. The usage tracking engine tracks all the usage of the various bits and pieces, so your websites, your service bus, your virtual machines, that kind of stuff. All that stuff is tracked in a usage database and kept there for a while. I think it's 40 days. And you can pull that data out using REST, OData, and JSON, whoever he is, and you can pull that stuff out and then use that to integrate into your billing engine. So, because basically there is no billing engine in the Azure pack, I guess be clear about that. The idea is that you integrate with an existing billing engine or chargeback mechanism or whatever. So what I've seen Microsoft demo, I haven't actually seen any information how it all works, is there's a data warehouse that they're shipping. There's also a performance point or SharePoint performance point analytics database for analyzing all the usage data and billing data. And also in they showed Excel pulling stuff out as well. So, you know, doing slice and dice with the usage data through Excel. And so that's kind of how the billing stuff and chargeback stuff works, is, you know, through the usage engine. I think at the end of this deck, so when you download the deck, there's three bit.ly URLs for a couple of interesting blog posts about the Azure pack. One of them actually goes into quite a bit of depth about the billing solution, so if you're interested in how the billing stuff works, then grab the deck. I think it should be available now anyway. Grab the deck, have a look at the billing stuff at the end, or the URLs at the end. The other bit is this for a service provider, automation is key. So I talked about the service management automation stuff. So if, like I say, I'm still a bit conflicted about service management automation. I still don't really know how it fits together. But what I would suggest is as more information becomes available, I think I put a link at the end of the deck as well on a whole bunch of service management automation posts, blog posts. So again, grab the deck and have a look at that. But basically this allows a service provider to have automation built into the portal, triggered off certain actions inside the portal as well. So, and also stuff that you can run manually as well. So, you know, so you can see various different, you can sort of see that's the automation portal view, same kind of thing. You can author the in fact, I think I've got a couple in here. Oops. Don't do that. Automation. So let's just have a look. Yeah. So in here, there's a couple of pre-built or pre-existing automation runbooks. And if I have a look at it, you'll see basically it's a bunch of boring stuff. Well, so basically, so the question is, when you do that stuff, is it possible to create, you know, customer users and groups and popular groups and that kind of stuff? It's PowerShell, so you can pretty much do what you like with it.
Does it show it in the UI, though, in the screen? Like the parameters, like for an end user tenant that wants to add a user to a hosting group?
That I'm not sure on. So the question was, does it provide parameters and stuff in the portal for end users to be able to do that, to you know, parameterize it? I'm not sure on that, to be honest. So that's so let me do that. Right. So that's there. So let's go. So let's just switch gears and talk about the architecture of this and how it all fits together. So basically there's a bunch of bits and pieces that make this thing up. There's management portals, there's some APIs, then there's the website stuff, there's the virtual machine stuff, and then there's kind of the other bits, which are databases and service bus and automation, that kind of stuff. But the key bits, I guess, when you look at the Azure Pack core, this is the core of the Azure Pack. These are, I guess, the seven bits of Azure Pack, plus there's SQL database sitting in the back end hanging it all together. So I guess you break it into three different groups. The portals, so there's a tenant portal and the admin portal. The APIs, so there's three different APIs. There's the admin API, the tenant private API, and the tenant public API. So the difference between the private API and the public API is the one that you would expose out to the internet if you had a bunch of tenants using it and they would talk to with their tools. The private API is what the tenant portal talks to, basically. And then there's a couple of authentication sites, the tenant authentication site and the admin authentication site. So those are kind of the main bits of the Azure Pack. And when you come to deploy, you get a bunch of options around how you deploy that stuff. Each of these can be deployed on separate machines if you want to. I think personally that's kind of overkill. So you probably would choose, unless you had a really large environment, if you're a massive hoster running tens of thousands of VMs, you probably wouldn't do it like this. For the website stuff, there's basically two bits of that. There's kind of the admin side of stuff and the content delivery side of stuff. The content delivery side stuff's really easy. It's basically there's front ends, and the front ends are basically running application request routing, and they run caching, and they're basically stateless caches. And you would network load balance those somehow. And basically all incoming website requests come into the front ends, they cache the data, they fire the requests off to the appropriate worker. And the workers we've got in the back end, there's basically you can have shared workers and reserved workers. And those shared workers are, you've got multiple IIS websites running on the same workers, reserved, basically dedicated to a particular instance. And all the content itself is stored on a file server in the back end. And the workers access the content off the file server. And that's kind of the content delivery bit of it, the admin bit of it. There's a controller machine, which is basically running the Microsoft WebFarm framework. I think it's a slightly modified version, though. And it talks to all the rest of the bits, talks to all the other bits in the environment. And does most of the action by talking through to the REST API server. So it tells the REST API server what to do and when to do it. And then you've got a publisher, and the publisher is how tenants connect to your environment to push content. So if you're pushing via Visual Studio, it goes through the publisher. If you're pushing via FTP, it goes through the publisher. You can, if you're running, I showed you the website service, you can scale up. And so if I'm running, three instances of a web, or two instances of a web server, I can drop a worker and it'll just keep working. If I'm only running one instance and it's running on the worker that happens to die, the controller will detect that and shift the load, shift the worker role over to another worker if there's one available. Obviously connections will die, but as it comes back up, it will reprovision that content. That's kind of and this is kind of harder to split out in terms of the roles. So you have dedicated front ends, dedicated workers, dedicated file services, and a dedicated REST environment, and probably a dedicated publisher. And in this lot, the only two bits that are exposed publicly or to the internet, if you're a service provider, is the publisher and the front ends. Everything else can sit inside the network. Virtual machines is really easy. There's SPF and there's VMM. That's pretty much all you've got to do. In terms of initial setup, to set up the Azure Pack base, it's Server 2012 or 2012 R2. You run up the web platform installer, install IIS, install .NET, recommended config, and install .NET 4.5. Disable IE enhanced security configuration. That's what it stands for, right? And you need SQL Server 2012 running in mixed mode. You can't use native mode. And then you install it from the web platform installer. Then when you configure it, basically the web page, you run it, you say, I want the, what the database server is and what the passphrase is going to be. And I wasn't going to show you a demo here, but I will. So, in fact, I'll show you a couple of things. I'll spin up that while we just look at this. So this is actually a blank Azure portal, just finished running setup, basically. And so, this is the same screen you'll see when you configure any of those seven components of the Azure Pack. You've got to give it a a database server, yep, and you've got to give it a passphrase. And the first time you create the passphrase, it will, in theory, yep, ask you to confirm it. Whenever you join any other role to the environment, or if you need to replace a role, you need to enter the passphrase. So don't forget what it is. So that's what you've got to do there. You've got to give it a domain name for what it looks like when someone accesses the machine from the internet, and basically away you go. And that'll go off and configure. This is a single install on a single machine. Now, where did that? So the other bit I wanted to just quickly show you is how to find the Azure Pack. So if you run out the web platform installer, actually just come into products and go to Windows Azure, and what you'll see, the Azure Pack stuff here is this bit here. There are all these things, these at the moment they all say preview. And so what you want to do, if you do want to do a single machine install, it's this Windows Azure Pack Portal and API Express, which basically installs everything. But you can see, you know, if I want to install the admin site on a separate box, I can just install that, or the admin API on a separate box, I can do that. So that's you know, that's how you get the Azure Pack. You just run up the web platform and installer, and away you go. And that will go off and configure, and that's done. And this should tell me that I'm not authorized. I think. Because I just want to quickly show you how you self-signed certificates for the win. And am I logged out? Creates a new group and adds you to the group. So what you'll find when you've installed it is you'll have these management service thingies, and then you go management service administration, and that just spins up IE. And in fact, while we're here, let's just quickly look at the what it does to IIS. So you can see all the various bits and pieces. So you can see it creates a whole bunch of websites for each different bit. There's a couple other bits there, which, you know, SQL Server and stuff, which just happen to go in the right place. So basically, now we've got a blank portal, and basically just add resources. So website clouds, probably the most complicated one. I'll add SQL because that's all I've got here in this environment. Is I can just add SQL Server. And so what I'm going to show you is probably what you would consider a worst practice, because I'm just going to point it at the same SQL Server instance that that's hosting my hosting databases. You really, 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 really shouldn't do this, because this will basically mean that all your hosting databases are running on the same one that all your users' websites are running on. So if you have to run it on the same box, run it as a separate instance at the very least. And we will just go next. And basically, it's done. And now we've got a SQL Server installed. And so that means I can go ahead and create a plan now that's got SQL databases in it. So it's, you know, most of the stuff is as simple as that. VMs, it's, you know, you register service provider foundation and you register your VM service and VMM service, and that's kind of it. So again, the website cloud is the only hard one. I'll talk about that now. So for website cloud, you've got to, same kind of stuff you've got to do, but you've also got some firewall rules you need to enable. And again, you need SQL Server, and you install the website's controller from the web platform installer, and then you configure up your database server name, same, you know, database server name, admin credentials, the domain that you want your websites to come into, and then you need to provide the machine that you're going to install the REST service on, a machine you're going to install the file server on, and away you go, and it will spin those things up for you. So that's why you need to have those firewall rules for WMI and SMB enabled, so it allows the website's controller to talk to the REST and file server box. And I guess the other bits are basically just register the stuff in the portal. So it's you know, it's actually reasonably simple to set up. And then other than that, add gallery resources and create plans. There you go. So a couple of deployment patterns. That's what an express install looks like. You've got all of Azure Pack sitting on one machine, SQL, well, in fact, you could have SQL sitting on the same box if you really want to. As I understand it, that's unsupported for production, but it's really good for test and POC installs if you want to just have a play with it, because you just go bang and it installs everything. If you were going to do an internal install, you might look at doing this kind of thing, have all the portals on one box, have all the APIs on another box, have authentication on another box. That's probably one way to do it. Or you might look at, if you were doing it external, this is kind of probably what you'd look at. You'd look at having the tenant portal, the tenant public API, and the tenant authentication sites all sitting on one box. That box would be exposed to the internet. Then the admin portal, the admin API, and the tenant private API all sitting inside, and not access to the internet. And same with the admin authentication in your SQL box. Question is, can you use multiple tenant sites, brand them differently, and use the same backend? I honestly don't know the answer to that. You can brand the tenant site. I can't see a good reason why you couldn't. There may be some URL complications, I don't know, but yeah. And then fully distributed, and my text all disappeared. Gone well, but fully distributed is basically, you know, everything separate boxes, and that's obviously if you're a host running tens of thousands of websites and VMs, then that might be what you do. Good. So that brings us to the end with a few minutes for questions. So basically, the idea with the Azure Pack, it's cloud enabling the system center and Windows Server stack. It's all the investments that Microsoft are making inside Windows Azure, bringing those to your on-premises and hosted cloud. I'm really sorry for having on-premise on there. That's not my fault. And consistency across clouds. Cloud OS, is that the latest buzzword bingo that we've had in the keynotes and stuff? And it is leveraging existing investments in Windows Server. So that's all I've got for you today. Thank you for having me back and listening and staying. So if there are any questions, give me a shout, or I'll hang around here for a while if you mind. Thank you.